Yeah. Get ready to see what's going to happen to you when you finish. I would like to thank Shirin for inviting me to this meeting. I would like to thank Pedro for taking most of my slides in his time. And thank you all for being here to help me do my psychotherapy. It was 1991 when I started dealing with dual career. I'll show you when that happened. And I'm very happy to see that 30 years later, there are many people interested in this. Pedro, Serene didn't tell me anything about the suit, so I don't wear one.
Your speech will compensate.
Okay. So this is me. To convince you that I was an athlete myself, track and field, 110-meter hurdles, and I was a good one. I won all the national championships at all ages. I met the qualifying standard for the Olympic Games. Did not go because of a slip disc injury. So I made it my life goal to study about sports management and dual career. So I started gathering information, and over the years, I've made a very long presentation on dual career, and I adjusted to the audiences I'm invited to speak to. Okay, the issue of the athlete's dual career is not new. We just found out a few years ago, but it goes back hundreds of years. Literature says that in Roman times there was a guy, Gaius Apuleius Diocles, who was a chariot driver, and in his career he made $15 billion. $15 billion today's dollars, and he lived a poor life, and he died poor. He died as rich as a servant of a middle-level merchant. So this goes on over the years and happens today as well. Pedro explained that nobody cares, so I don't have to go through this. You know it already. And there's a few statistics here to convince you what's going on with athletes when they finish their career. 78%, they go bankrupt, or they have financial problems, or they get divorced, or both. I was no rich guy. I was a track and field athlete, no money for us. But when I finished my career, I was forced to finish my career because I was injured, I was divorced, and I was bankrupt as well. So I know firsthand. Same thing happens with 60% of the NBA players. And some of the excuses. Athletes have many excuses. I'm an athlete, I'm not a student, I do not need it, I want immediate results. There are all sorts of excuses. This is how I was looking in life because of my event. And later on I found out that all sport, all people, all athletes have a tunnel vision. They see only when they touch the finish line, when they shoot the basket. Nothing else matters. Athletes forget that there are seven phases in their life, and coaches always stay at line five, from play to introduction to sport, to the beginning of a sporting career, to development, to establishment. Nothing else. There are two more phases. So on the decline, you go down, you cannot avoid it, it's nature, and then you have to adapt in a new life. That's the hard part. That's why it's in red. That's very hard. What happens to the athletes who try to adapt in a new life? They cannot manage adrenaline. Adrenaline flows either you want it or not. So if you trained your body 29 years to have twice a day a training session, adrenaline flows. And when you stop, you cannot switch off. Adrenaline flows. And adrenaline flows, and you get angry, and you get mad, and you get anxious, and you fight with people. And you don't know what to do. Nobody tells you what to do. Nobody knows. You find out the hard way. Then you have to transcend to a new environment. You're an athlete, everybody calls you, everybody is interested in you. Media, journalists, when you are done, nobody calls you. So you go through an identity crisis. And if you're not prepared, it's easy to get into drugs, to get into alcohol, to get into gambling, and other things. There's an example for you. There are many. I could talk to you about examples for very long, but she told me she will interrupt me in 12 minutes. How much time do I have? I cannot do it. I cannot do it. I need six. Okay. And then people like him, idols, world idols, go bankrupt. Why? Because nobody told them how to use their money. Can we play this video? No? Okay, then I will describe it. I will describe it. I saw it 3 years ago, an accident happened in Greece. And when I watched it on television, the minute it was happening, I was seeing myself in that accident. It was a Porsche running, speeding maybe 200 kilometers per hour. A tire breaks, an explosion happens. The car slides in flames, falls on a parked car. Two kids in the Porsche get killed, and there is a mother with an infant in the other car, got killed as well. And the Porsche tumbled over outside the highway and burned out. So to my mind, the time that the tire broke was the time that I had a slip disc injury. The slide was the many months I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what happened to me, and I didn't know how to do with my adrenaline rushes, and I didn't know nothing. And when the car hit the other car and four people died, for me it was the moment that many people around me died, because me not knowing what to do and how to handle the situation, I fought with everybody. Everybody was in blame. My mother and father, you didn't raise me well. My brother, you are a lousy brother. And my wife, you're worthless. So many people died in my life. So when you get this presentation, take 3 minutes. Look at it and you will see yourself. I hope not. Now that you are prepared, you are warned. Opportunities, there are many opportunities. In every difficult situation, there are opportunities as well. And one opportunity that I found for myself is that I had the chance to live twice. When you die, I mean, when you crash on a wall with 200 kilometers per hour, you are dust. Then you have two choices. Either you commit suicide, as Pedro said, the two athletes did, and there are many others who committed suicide. The other one is to rebuild yourself. I chose second way, and I had the opportunity to live twice. The big benefit of this is that when you are 27, you know how to rebuild yourself. When you are born, you're influenced by everybody else. Your father and mother tells you what to do. Your brother shapes you. The school shapes you. Your relatives shape you. And you are somebody else's product. When you die and you resurrect again, you can choose which ingredients you put in your character. So to give you an example, when I did this process, I selected not to be discouraged characteristic. So I'm never discouraged. So no matter what happens to me, I'm never discouraged. I saved my life on this side. Ultimately, I'm convinced that the worst thing that happened to me would be turned upside down and become the best thing that happened to me. So I take every opportunity I'm given to share this with anyone who is interested to listen and prepare the minds of the athletes that are coming to that end. It was very nice for you to be before me. So, as far as the values, Serene put the word values in my presentation. The IOC has done a great work. Olympic values education. Everybody in this room should get this document in their hands and develop classes after this. I wish I had a couple of hours to discuss more, but I don't. So I just give you the headlines of what you can do. There's reports like this, what sport can do. 83 pages, around 150 benefits that derive from sport. I made also a very long presentation on what sport can do, and I promised Serene to translate it into English and send it to her. And whoever else wants it, I will be happy to provide. This is an Erasmus Plus program that I participated called Aftermaths. You should need to read about this. These are the skills athletes develop during their sporting career, and it's an excellent selling point for sports people to tell to the parents of kids to convince them that it's a good thing for their kids to be in sport, because they get these skills just because they're athletes. They don't need to have any education on these things. But other things are helping athletes to go through this process. This is the Olympic Charter, the latest one, the latest version. Article 2, mission and role of the IOC, line 12, to encourage and support the efforts of sport organizations and public authorities to provide for the social and professional future of athletes. They are obliged. Every organization, sport organization in the world who is under the Olympic Charter is obliged to provide these services. And we, that we are in the service of athletes, we need to use this, take this to our authorities and tell them, look, the IOC dictates, it doesn't advise, the IOC dictates that dual career prospects should be organized in all countries. Then the IOC produced this. They have established a series of educational opportunities, small videos, small educational things for athletes who are interested. It's for free. I mean, you yourselves and your athletes should be registered and receive what they offer every now and then. This is the webpage, olympic.org/athletes365. It's free. Please register. This is the European Sports Charter. There is an article for the support of top level and professional sport. There are some red letters. Governments are obliged to help athletes into a smooth integration to society through development of career prospects during and after sporting excellence. I'm very proud that I convinced them when they were doing it, I was involved in the process, and I convinced them to include these words in that article. There used to be a full stop where the training institutes there, it was a full stop. And I made a scene when they were discussing, and they accepted my proposal to include this. This produced this document, European Union Guidelines on Dual Career. It's not obligatory, it's not mandatory, but it's a very good source of advice. All governments should listen to them. And we everybody who teaches in the university or in national academies, for that matter, they should incorporate this into their teachings. National Basketball Player Association, they have a specific service helping rookies to develop a career after they finish playing basketball. World Players Association, they have established their guidelines for their rights and responsibilities. Top right, they recognize themselves. PDMs, Sergio talked to you about earlier, is education. Athletes realize education is important, and in any way they can, they enforce their education among the members and to the appropriate authorities when it comes to them. Big time sporting federations include life skills into their athletes program. This is the lifelong program for wrestlers in the United States. So they have included life skills there as well. There are many international initiatives, as you can see, I'm sure you recognize them. World Olympians Association have started doing things for those who retire. And I'm sure we all agree that knowledge is power. Very good knowledge is produced by a program like this. Life after sport produces knowledge, but along with knowledge comes responsibility. And we have to try to convince our athletes that the moment of victory is too short to do like just like this, just like only this. I mean, I was training for 365 days per year for what? For 14 seconds. I mean, I think this is crazy. I stopped going to the beach. I interrupted my relationship with my friends. I was like a slave to what I was doing. I enjoyed that at that time, but 10 years later, I feel that I missed something. Not something, many things. So, it's good for the athletes to do, to follow dual career, because they have a lot of benefits. This initiative, Life After Sport, falls under the Sustainable Development Goals established by the United Nations. This goes far away than simple task. So we have to join forces to make sure that no one is left behind. We care about everybody. We should care about everybody, not the Olympic medal winners. Thank you for your attention. Any questions? Yes.
Hi to everyone. You said you're training 365 days in a year for 14 seconds. But after the finish line, does it worth it?
Does it what?
Worth it. The
now,
feeling.
Today?
Today, no. Back then.
Back then?
Yeah.
Back then, as Pedro said, that was the only thing I had in mind.
Yeah, but does it worth it when you win?
It was worth it, yes.
So?
Yeah, if I had somebody, my coach, to tell me what Martina said, the moment of winning is too short just to live for this, I would have made, maybe I would have made other choices. Certainly, I would go to the, I mean, when kids in Greece, when kids have finished high school, they go to a five-day trip. Okay? I didn't go to that five-day trip because I had competition. And now there are 35 people with common memories. I'm not in them.
If you can change it, do you?
I would. Of course I would. I would go all the way there. All the way.
Okay, thanks.
Somebody in the back.
Thanks, Dimitri, for your presentation. I just had a question. You mentioned a lot of policy.
Can you speak louder a little bit?
Sorry. You mentioned a lot of policy documents or charters in relation to dual careers, but could you give us a quick overview or summary of a country that has implemented those? So describe a good practice of a country that has implemented dual careers within their...
She doesn't allow me to extend more than I have done already. France is doing a good work. United Kingdom is doing a good work. United States is doing a good work. Australia, there are many countries that they are doing a good work. There are many examples we can discuss later if you want. I have included a few examples there for you to see. You're from Ireland, right? Rugby players in Ireland have a great, their program is worth £5 million every year for the dual career program. Go do an internship there.
Thank you.
Pedro. The microphone is coming.
If you had the power in your own country, what would be the next steps for you for dual career?
The next step?
Yes, in Greece.
EU guidelines on dual career, I would make them law. As it is, to my advisory committee, please take these EU guidelines into the process of becoming a law. There's a process there. So in half a year, 6 months, there would be a law in Greece enforcing everybody that is included in the EU guidelines, athletes themselves, their coaches, their parents, their clubs, everybody who is involved in the entourage of the athletes to implement these rules. Easy. But the people who are in charge don't understand it. But we'll make them understand, don't we?
No more questions?
No? Okay. Thank you.